Good morning. The December commencement ceremonies are about to begin. Color Guard, please post the colors. Dina Haberle of Rustburg, Virginia, and Megan Nelson of Opaka, Wisconsin, graduating seniors, will now lead us in the singing of our national anthem.
Say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hail as the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the
Please be seated. Julie Moon, a graduating senior in aerospace engineering from Albuquerque, New Mexico, will now give the invocation.
Dear Heavenly Father, we're grateful for the opportunity to come here and have learned these many years that we've been in school, and we're grateful for the opportunity for all of our family and friends to be able to make it through in safety, and we ask a blessing upon this ceremony that it will be a joyous occasion, and we say these things in the name of Jesus' name, Heavenly Father's name, Jesus Christ, amen.
First, I'd like to welcome everyone for this, our fall commencement of 1999. I'd like to thank the ROTC Cadet Color Guard for posting the colors. It's always important to recognize our heritage. Also, thanks to Deaner Haberly and Megan Nelson for the singing of the national anthem, and Julie Moon for her invocation. I'd certainly like to draw attention, as we do at each commencement, to the fact that we have flags on either side of the podium that represent the countries of our graduating international students. It is important that we enrich ourselves with other cultures in our global economy and our global environment. Also, I'd like to make sure for parents, family, friends, that this is an important occasion for these graduates. I certainly want to make sure that you have every opportunity to take as many photographs as you possibly could want. You are welcome to take photographs throughout the entire ceremony. The only thing we ask is that you keep the front portion of the area clear so that they can move up and back to their seats. There is a cordon on the side to help you. So please, take pictures. Also, after the ceremony, we will retire to the old gym next door. There will be a reception for our new graduates, as well as for the families and friends. Faculty and staff will be there as well. I'd like to introduce the platform party, our commencement speaker, Mike Conway, who I'll introduce here shortly, our Board of Trustees representative, Mr. John Olson, our Dean of Academics, Dr. Peter Quigley, and also our Dean of Students, Jim Kula. We also have many distinguished visitors with us. In addition to the Board of Trustees, we also have members of our Board of Visitors, friends of the campus, friends of the university. It is a distinct pleasure for me to welcome our commencement speaker. Mike Conway is the founder of National Airlines. He's developed an initial concept and strategy of the status for a new airline startup, and a very ingenious startup, I might add. Based on many initial elements to it, he manages virtually all aspects of the business with a great deal of help from a very well-chosen staff. Very innovative in how he approaches this particular critical point in the business, a very tough part of the business, but he will tell you he enjoys it a great deal and has a lot of fun with it. He's got 25 years of experience in the airline business, was co-founder of America West Airlines when it started up, currently based in Las Vegas, Nevada with his airline, National Airlines. He served from 1981 to 1993 with America West Airlines as a CEO, Chief Operating Officer, President and Executive Vice President and CFO. He has an experience in 11 years as Price Waterhouse and specialized in airline and large international corporations. It is a distinct pleasure to recognize and welcome the Chairman of the Board, President, and Chief Executive Officer of National Airlines, Mike Conway.
Thank you, Chancellor Kapp, distinguished faculty members, family and friends, and very soon to be graduates. Congratulations to you. A few months ago, when I received the honor of having the opportunity to speak before this group, something interesting happened, and this will give you an idea of what an intimidating boss I am on the job. My executive assistant, a lady who's been working with me for about 15 years, of course, she opens up every piece of mail I ever get, and she mentioned to me this invitation, and I said, that's terrific, and she said, Yeah, it's only taken them 15 years to get over what you talked about last time. Being before a group like this and sensing the energy and enthusiasm that the young graduates have is very special to me. If you would have told me, when I was your age or a little bit younger, that I would have this honor, I would have said, you've got to be kidding. I think it's important to give you a little frame of reference, and I'll tell you a little bit about my academic career. And the theme to this will be anything is possible. I graduated from high school before my 17th birthday, and it had nothing to do with academic achievement. The teachers that I had were motivated by two things: to get me through as quickly as possible, and while I should have been left back on several occasions, the idea of these teachers having me 2 years in a row was totally unacceptable. I then continued my academic pursuits in college with the sole purpose of being a basketball player, of which I had some prowess. My career as a college basketball player was short-lived. I had made two miscalculations. A, I really wasn't that good, and B, I never got any taller. Now, after my first semester in the City University of New York, my grades were 1D and 5 Fs. My academic friends referred to me as DIFF. My GPA index was 0.18. And for years, my mother could be heard muttering, he could have at least gotten a whole number. Well, I kind of bounced around and went to Manhattan, and the best job I could get was in the mailroom. And then it dawned on me, you know, maybe there really is something to going to school. And I went back to City College in the evening, and I finished college 4 years at night while working full-time in the daytime, and had a lot of help and encouragement along the way. Another major turning point in my life was after college I enlisted in the Marine Corps. And they took what runaway train was left in me, and they got me back in the right direction. Since that time, I've been very, very fortunate. Back in 1981, when myself and a few other people got together with the idea that maybe we should start an airline out of Phoenix, this was the beginning of deregulation. We had a fabulous opportunity and created an airline that has become the only major airline to come around in the last 20 years, a major airline being one that has revenues annually of more than $1 billion. I believe what we're doing in Las Vegas with our all 757 fleet, I believe National Airlines will be the next major airline. Throughout my career, I've met so many people, some real good people, some not so good people. But as I was talking to some of the faculty members, I've met a group of people, and I don't know that there are many people who could say that they've had dealings with most of the people who have walked on the moon. I remember being in a golf tournament and spent a few days with Alan Shepard. And at dinner one night, I said to Alan, what kind of golf ball did you hit on the moon? I mean, that's the most profound thing I could come up with. And he said, you know, Mike, Everybody has asked me that question. Golf ball manufacturers have offered me incredible amounts of money to say that I hit their golf ball. I haven't even told my wife what golf ball I hit, to which I leaned over and whispered in his ear, "You can tell me, Al." I had business dealings with Pete Conrad when he was an executive at McDonnell Douglas. I think it's fair to say that we did not get along. We never could come to any dealings. I don't think he really liked me. Maybe what set him off when he made one, in my view, unreasonable proposal after another, I accused him of maybe having taken too many loops up there. But that didn't work out so good. Gene Cernan, I spent some time with, a remarkable man. But the most remarkable person that I've ever had the pleasure of spending some time with was Neil Armstrong. A few years ago, General Electric took a number of executives in the airline industry on a week-long golf trip to Scotland. And we flew over there in a private jet, and Neil Armstrong was also in that group. And I got to pal around with Neil because most of the gentlemen who were on this trip were near retirement or some recently retired, and Neil was the only person who would play 36 holes a day with me. We got on very well, and then coming home a week later, we're sitting having a drink on the airplane, and he said, "You know, Mike, we've been with each other now for a week. And throughout that entire time, you haven't asked me one question about the moon." He said, and you can imagine how this guy gets inundated all the time with these types of questions. So he said, "Mike, why is that? Why haven't you asked me one question about the moon?" And I said to him, "Well, Neil, I'm just not interested in it." To which he then, we had a good laugh over that, and he then talked to me quite a bit about it. And this is a very reserved gentleman, a very proud gentleman, and what he talked about was something he really doesn't talk about, was the whole emotional experience of that, and I felt very special. So I've had a lot of opportunity and a lot of good fortune. I've been to many similar type graduations. I refer back to my own, which was in 1969 at Carnegie Hall, and then Vice President Hubert Humphrey gave the commencement address, and I'm embarrassed to say I can't remember one thing from that address. That's probably more a factor of my retention ability than it was with the things that Mr. Humphrey had said. But then I've been to several others, and I really don't recall anything that was lasting, with the exception of one thing. And that was about 4 years ago, at my son's graduation from the University of San Francisco. And the president of the college, Jesuit Father Schlegel, was talking to the soon-to-be graduates and reminding them of all of the things that they needed to get ready for when you get out there in the real world. And maybe you've heard some people give you that caution. And he ended his address to the students and their families with this statement. He said, "The real world is very much overrated." And that was it. And I got to tell you, he's right. He didn't explain why. He sort of left it to everybody to figure out for themselves. And I'll give you my version of why I think he was accurate. This is a very, very special time for you graduates. Maybe never again will you be with so many of your peers who have a common goal. And the goal is twofold. Your goals were to learn and to graduate. And I congratulate you on achieving that. Now, here's what I think you will experience in the overrated real world. You will no longer be in that type of peer group. You will now, no matter what venture you go into, be it the military, private practice, entrepreneurial pursuits, you will now meet a variety of people in your business careers. You will meet the hard chargers, the people with blind ambition, people whose primary goal is material attainment. You will meet a large number of what I call steady Eddies, people who will get the job done, but nothing more, nothing less. You will meet people who need to be jump-started every day in order to get anything done. You will meet people of much different age groups. You will meet people like yourselves just starting their careers. You will meet people who are just ending their careers and are ready for retirement. And of course, everybody in between. You will encounter good bosses. You will encounter lousy bosses and everybody in between. And then there's the attitude, the attitudes that are out there. And I'll give you the spectrum there. You'll meet some wonderful people. You'll want to know where they've been because you want to go there, because they're in a perpetual state of ecstasy. Nothing bothers these people. You will also meet that group who I refer to as the group who undoubtedly will be unhappy in heaven, and everybody in between. Some of you will have the opportunity to seek entrepreneurial pursuits, like I was fortunate in doing. Those of you who do take that course, I think you will find that the absolute most rewarding thing you can do in business is to create jobs. And when you do, I would encourage you to treat that as a sacred trust. Try to make the jobs that you've created the best job that that person has ever had. And if you do that, the reward that you will get emotionally, in all likelihood financially, which I always have believed is a supplemental benefit at best, will last you the rest of your life. People have asked me to perhaps comment on what I see in the aerospace industry, travel and tourism that might be coming down the road in the next 10 or 12 years. I would love to stand up here and wax eloquent on that, but quite frankly, I'm just not that smart. If you go back 10 years ago and see if anyone 10 years ago was able to predict the state that the industry is in now, be it the consolidation in aerospace with Boeing and Airbus industries now essentially controlling the marketplace, companies like McDonnell Douglas and Lockheed for the most part, mere memories, the huge surge in airline alliances with the major U.S. Carriers now going global. That's just what has happened in the last 10 years. I believe that the changes that will take place in the next 10 years will be just as profound. This is an industry that is not going away. The internet will not replace this industry until Scotty can really find a way to beam people up and down. People will be moving from one place to the other. The distribution channels and how services are acquired are certainly being impacted by the internet. If I try to leave you with a thought that perhaps you'll remember in your career with everything that is going on, I will leave you with this, because it has worked very well for me. You will have successes and you will have failures throughout your business career and life experiences. I think you should learn from both equally. But the things that have served me well throughout my career are the following. I would suggest to you, you should always work hard. I would also suggest to you that in your dealings with others, be honest, and be honest with yourself. Treat people fairly, and never stop learning. If you do those things, then I think you'll be just fine, and you'll be a better person for it. So, I congratulate you again. I thank you and the university for having me back here. It really is something special for me to be here. Thank you very much.
Each graduating class selects one student to speak on behalf of the graduates. This fall's class has selected Heidi Kaiser. Heidi, if you'd come up. Heidi came to Embry-Riddle from Royal Oak, Michigan, and majored in aerospace engineering. Very active in both campus and community activities, she also was very active in Air Force ROTC. In fact, in the year 1998 to 1999, she was a national commander of Arnold Air Society. Commissioned a second lieutenant in the Air Force, she's heading off to Beale Air Force Base in Yuba City, California, and then a follow-on to undergraduate pilot training at Laughlin Air Force Base in Del Rio, Texas. Heidi's dream, to one day become an astronaut. Heidi.
Not a big fan of tassels in my face, so we're going to take that off for now. Well, thank you, class of 1999, for giving me this honor to speak. So, good morning, honored guests, and good morning, class of 1999. Needless to say, I'm more than excited to be up here to speak, and I know that everybody down here is excited to be here. I'm sure some of us feel like it's a miracle, like on my hat, it's a miracle. I'm here today graduating with an aerospace engineering degree, but again, that's a whole different story. Well, my esteemed peers, we've made it. We've made it through years of what seemed to be a mix of heaven and, well, it's politically correct opposite. It's hard to believe that a little over 4 years ago, most of us were driving up to the school, eager to begin a new chapter in our lives. And I can say these past 4 years, we've had more than a chapter in our lives added. It seems more like it's an Encyclopedia Britannica set. Anyhow, 4 years ago, we entered the dorms, and we entered the part of college in which we wanted to participate in. For some of us, fraternities and sororities seemed the right choice. Others delved into ROTC programs, Student Government Association. There were intramural sports, wrestling, and there were a whole bunch of other campus organizations. Either way, we were about to make friendships that were going to last us a lifetime, and these friendships are what have brought us here today to graduation. There have been so many memories made here, many that are way too precious to forget. so don't. Well, we definitely grew older here, I would say. I think our parents dropped us off hoping we would learn a little bit about that thing we call life, at least the responsible side of it, how to take care of ourselves, how to pay bills, and how to eat right. And I think that eating right came after we moved out of the dorms. I think we did learn a lot about life. I think the most important lessons that we learned here at Embry-Riddle were about life. Now, don't get me wrong, school is important. I mean, my goodness, I have had some great daydreams in classes, and I have some great pictures on my notes. But on a serious side, we have gotten a lot out of it. After all, we're graduating, aren't we? We should know a little bit about our degree program, I hope. But as much as I joke about it, we all have learned a great discipline in our classes. And whether or not we know it or we want to admit it, we are getting an education from one of the finest universities in the world. And for that, we should truly, truly be proud. We've endured classes like aircraft prelim, double E prelim, senior thesis, writing papers for an infamous Juan Lucena, COM, EMAG, ENAV, flight physiology, digital design, and real-time systems. They are so full of lessons, whether or not we really want to admit it. For the AEs, I'm going to be a little partial here, but one thing I've learned is that you can throw a bunch of equations up in the air and grab them up, playing 52 pickup and design a plane, you're doing that. Or if you're not doing something's not going the right way while you're wading through the math, all you got to do is assume that you're in an isotropic regime and things work themselves out. Now, I know all the degree programs have their own little jokes. Whether some went to class to see Superman Randy, or others debated with teachers from Harvard, or others talked with their favorite teacher about their favorite kind of scotch, or getting offered an A for finding a beer in record time. Although we have all these jokes, we have learned a tremendous amount. At this time, I feel it is only appropriate to recognize the faculty and the staff here at Embry-Riddle. After all, we really wouldn't be here without them. I know there's a lot of teachers here that are truly, truly here for the students, and they make sure that every student that walks through their door walks out with something also. Whether it's a kick in the pants, they walk out with something. And even those that aren't teachers, whether they're academic chair people, they're the library staff, the AV staff, the chief operating officer, dean of students, they have all gone out of their way for the students. So at this time, I would like to ask faculty and staff for you to please stand so you can be recognized. And one last thing to support them. While here, Colonel Clue said I was the National Commander for Arnold Air Society. And I think the most important lesson I learned out of it is I was able to meet with Air Force ROTC cadets across the nation. And you know, not once out of the 134 detachments that I got to talk to did I run into anybody whose staff and faculty was more supportive of the students than those here at Embry-Riddle. So again, thank you very much. Let's now focus on the families here. We've got parents, grandparents, spouses, and siblings. Thank you so much for your support. You're always there to give us that extra boost, have encouraging words when things were down, and just listen to us when things were rough. I know especially this last year, my parents have endured my tears of frustration and were there to push me on when I kind of wanted to give things up. Yes, it is you, families, that have kept us strong and kept us grounded in even the biggest storms. So thank you very much for that. Now, the graduating class. We should be very proud of ourselves. We've gone through a lot, and by golly, we're still here. We've learned a little bit about what's called life, and now we're going out into the real world, which is pretty scary. Now, getting ready for the real world, it's kind of a reality check, and sometimes it drives us to think of what a movie title once said, reality bites. But needless to say, it's here, and we've got to go on. So if some of us are going out to flight instruct, the fate of your students lies in your hands. Some of us are going out to fly. The fate of your passengers and the success of your mission lies in your hands. Some of us are going on to work for Boeing or Raytheon. The future of technology is in your hands, my friends. Others will go on into business. Some will continue their education. And still, there's other jobs that are out there. But no matter what, the future is in our hands, and that is such an awesome, awesome responsibility. You know, reality sure has hit me. Yesterday, I was commissioned. Myself and 16 of my fellow classmates were going into the Air Force. Four are going into the Army, one into the Navy, one into the Marines. And the reality of this is that although we're going into some great jobs, and I mean great jobs, we're going to have to remember the bottom line here is that we're here to protect our country and everything that our country stands for. And if time comes, our commitment means everything. And that means includes giving our lives to make sure that America is safe. And I know we're ready to do that, and I know the rest of the class is ready to step into the responsibility of their futures. Class of 99, we have done it. We are here, and we're going into the next chapter of our lives. And as we do this, let's keep a quote in mind from General George S. Patton, Jr. It says, "I do not fear failure. I only fear the slowing up of the engine inside of me that's pounding, saying, keep going. Somebody needs to be on top. Why not me?" Congratulations, and thank you.
Thank you, Heidi. Actually, I was listening to our guest today, Mike Conway, speak about people who he's known. I thought maybe we could even think about a new faculty evaluation. I began to imagine steady eddies, people you have to jumpstart every morning, and those who are unhappy even in heaven. Little checkbox. Well, anyway, we can talk about that later. I would like now to invite Colonel William Hopewell to the podium, please. Commander of Air Force ROTC Detachment 28, and he will now conduct the Air Force commissioning ceremony.
Will the 17 new Air Force lieutenants please come to the podium? The mission of Air Force ROTC is to produce future leaders for the United States Air Force and better citizens for the United States. These individuals standing behind me are the new leadership that will take us into the 21st century. It is now my privilege to administer the oath of office to these new commissionees. Please raise your right hand. I, state your full name.
I, General Jason Gross.
Having been appointed a second lieutenant
in the United States Air Force,
do solemnly swear,
that I will support,
and defend the Constitution of the United States, against all enemies, foreign and domestic. That I will bear true faith, and allegiance to the same. That I take this obligation freely, without any mental reservation, or purpose of evasion. And that I will well, and faithfully discharged, the duties of the office.
Upon him about to enter.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Put your hands down. Ladies and gentlemen, the newest second lieutenants in your United States Air Force.
Will Major Scott Burgess, officer in charge of the Army ROTC, please come to the podium to conduct the Army commissioning ceremony.
Army commissioning is on your feet! Post!
Raise your right hand. Repeat after me. I state your name.
I, Matthew Malone.
Anthony Lawrence Pereiras.
Isaac Schultz.
Noel Van Skirley.
Having been appointed an officer.
Having been appointed an officer.
In the Army of the United States.
In the Army of the United States.
In the rank of second lieutenant.
In the rank of second lieutenant.
Do solemnly swear.
Do solemnly swear.
To support and defend.
To support and defend
the Constitution of the United States.
The Constitution of the United States.
Against all enemies.
Against all enemies.
Foreign and domestic.
Foreign and domestic.
And that I will bear true faith.
And that I will bear true faith.
And allegiance to the same.
And allegiance to the same.
That I take this obligation freely.
That I take this obligation freely.
Without any mental reservation.
Without any mental reservation.
Or purpose of evasion.
Or purpose of evasion.
And will well and faithfully.
And will well and faithfully.
Discharge the duties.
Discharge the duties.
Of the office that I'm about to enter.
Of the office I'm about to enter.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Congratulations, you're now officers and gentlemen.
Mr. Fred Cohn, Interim Director of the School of Aviation Sciences, will now conduct the Marine Commissioning Ceremony.
Dale Hall. Left face. The Department of the Navy and the United States Marine Corps take great pleasure in offering a commission as a Lieutenant of Marines to Chris Nelson. Before we do this and administer this last oath, I would like to ask all of the newly commissioned officers in the Army and the Air Force to stand and face outboard to the crowd. At the same time, I would like to ask everyone who has ever served in the armed forces to stand in recognition and support of all of these new officers in the military. Would you please stand? Candidate, if you're ready to assume the office of a Lieutenant of Marines and the duties and responsibilities thereto, face left and raise your right hand. Repeat after me. I, Fred Cohn.
I, Chris Nelson.
Do solemnly swear.
Do solemnly swear.
To support and defend.
To support and defend.
The Constitution of the United States.
The Constitution of the United States.
Against all enemies.
Against all enemies.
Both foreign and domestic.
Both foreign and domestic.
That I will bear true faith and allegiance to the same.
That I will bear true faith and allegiance to the same.
That I take this obligation freely.
That I take this obligation freely.
Without mental reservation.
Without mental reservation.
Or purpose of evasion.
Or purpose of evasion.
That I will well and faithfully.
That I will well and faithfully.
Discharge the duties.
Discharge the duties.
Of the office.
Of the office.
On which I am about to enter.
On which I am about to enter.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Ready? Two. Right face. This time, Cap Parlier, Colonel of Marines, will present the lieutenant his sword. The sword is a symbol of the arms that all of the lieutenants have sworn to bear in the defense of our country and for you and me. Left face, forward heart.
I always hate to follow Fred after that. Prior to this commencement ceremony, each academic program is given the task of selecting one student who best fits the phrase, most outstanding graduate. The faculty from that program will review the student's academic record. They also review the contributions the student has made within the extended campus and the community. A return engagement. Will Mr. Fred Cohn please come to the podium to present the Aviation Sciences Awards?
In selecting the outstanding graduate for Aviation Science, it was a real difficult task. As a matter of fact, the faculty had nominated more than a dozen people to receive this award. The eventual winner distinguished himself by making the dean's list every semester he was here. In addition, he made the national dean's list. He was qualified to graduate summa cum laude. Besides all the academic achievements, he was elected to who's who in American colleges and universities. He maintained a family. He worked full time at many jobs around the Prescott area and even on the campus as a lab instructor in the physics lab and as a tutor for the campus. And I don't know how he found time besides doing all that, but he did work in the community for such places as Habitat for Humanities. It's with a great deal of pleasure I announce the outstanding graduate for Aviation Sciences at Robert Carlson. Would you come forward, please, Robert?
Professor Tracy Dorlin, Chair of the Aerospace Engineering Department, please present the Aerospace Engineering Award.
As Professor Cohn has indicated, this is always a very difficult selection process. Embry-Riddle has a lot of outstanding students, and it's difficult to choose one who shines more than the others. But it's a task that we as faculty have to do. The young man that was chosen for this award from Aerospace Engineering has distinguished himself in being selected to Sigma Gamma Tau, the Aerospace Engineering Honorary Society. He has been a member of AIAA, the student branch of American Institute of Astronautics and Aeronautics. He's been involved with the Embry-Riddle Astronomical Society. He, in addition to this, has been a participant in the Student Government Association. And besides all of that, he had time to graduate summa cum laude with a GPA of approximately 3.98. It's my distinguished privilege to present this award to Mr. Arvind Raman.
Dr. Richard Bloom, will you please come to the podium and present the Science, Technology, and Globalization Award?
By the way, figuratively and literally, my hat is off to all of you. Mike Conway made a comment about reality being overrated and not all it should be or can be. I'd like to talk about an individual who can help change that. Intellectual rigor, outstanding judgment, impeccable communication skills, compassionate social responsibility, sterling character, unlimited leadership potential. These are what we seek to develop in our science, technology, and globalization students as they seek to master the nuances of a rapidly changing world, especially how changes in science, technology, and globalization are affecting who we are. Our STG Outstanding Graduate is an exemplification of all these characteristics. She produced a significant research document on an important public policy issue, a document that may well change debate and legislative activities in Washington concerning the reduction of gross social inequities, a document that truly mirrors fiscal pragmatism with social compassion. She also has developed quite a facility in developing executive summaries on complex issues, leading group activities, group projects, and demonstrating critical thinking and analytic skills. This student has maintained such a high GPA that with all gravity, I can tell you it defies gravity. Finally, our STG Outstanding Graduate is being recognized today not only for what she has accomplished, but for what we in the university expect from her in the future. Please join me in congratulating our STG Outstanding Graduate, one of this country's future leaders, we believe, Ms. Melanie Antonich.
Dr. Chuck Cohn will please come to the podium now and present the Electrical Engineering Award.
Peter Quigley remarked earlier how hard it was to follow Fred to the podium. You should try and be in the same family. The outstanding electrical engineering graduate is Peter Mund. Will you please come forward, Peter? While he's coming forward, Peter's a member of Eta Kappa Nu. He worked for information technology for several years, establishing the backbone of our computer system around campus. He was one of only five students in our history to graduate with a straight 4.0. ROTC, he was a leader in ROTC. So, Peter.
The Chancellor's Award honors an outstanding scholar and leader in the graduating class who had an exceptional record of academic excellence, made significant accomplishments in campus leadership roles, and had a high level of both extracurricular involvement and service to the community. In recognition of his or her accomplishments, this graduate receives a plaque and a $500 check. Our Chancellor, Cap Pollier, will now present this award.
Somehow the reality oftentimes lessens the significance of what we must do in selecting awardees. It is always difficult, as you will learn and meet some of these graduates, that we have many graduates who qualify and certainly would recognize being recognized as the Chancellor's Award winner. The committee is involved in selecting or recommending to the Chancellor who is that person to be awarded the Chancellor's Award. As Jim explained, we try to find the person who has the greatest scholastic achievement, the greatest community service, and the greatest reward, the greatest significance, the greatest potential for future achievement. And it is never easy. And this year we had two, I think, that finished through all the selections. The committee recommended that we recognize both. I think in reality, to do that lessens the significance of the award. So it's left to me to have to pick. And it's often a very humbling experience when you realize that the candidates that you have exceed the achievements of many people who you are associated with, including your own. I want to take an exception for this ceremony and recognize not only the person who won the award, but the person who came the closest to winning the award. The runner-up for the Chancellor's Award had a GPA of 3.98. We get a degree in aeronautical engineering, which is not an easy one to achieve. Secretary of Sigma Gamma Tau, an SGA representative, recipient of the Embry-Riddle Presidential and Academic Merit Scholarships, is involved in International Students Association, and I think most significantly recognize his work as a tutor, helping other students to achieve, using his intellect to achieve. So in that, I would like to ask Arvid Raman to stand and be recognized as the runner-up. Oftentimes, I wish I had about 10 or 12 of these awards to be able to give out to people with the achievements of Arvid. This year's winner for the Chancellor's Award finished with an overall GPA of 3.82, 3.99 in his electrical engineering discipline. Had minors in mathematics and physics, was the president of Eta Kappa Nu, doubly honor society, volunteers his time to the YMCA, First Lutheran Church in town, local VA hospital helping veterans who are in need, roadside cleanup among others, served in intramurals, been on the skydiving club, caving club, climbing club, U.S. triathlete, series competitor, been on the Prescott swim team. He was also the wing commander of the Air Force ROTC detachment that led the sixth largest of 143 Air Force ROTC units in this country. This little campus, the sixth largest in the country. As you'll recognize, he's also been honored by his compatriots for superior performance in his ROTC unit and has been commissioned a second lieutenant in the United States Air Force. He's off to Incirlik Air Force Base in Adana, Turkey, and after some tour there, will join a very highly selective Euro-NATO joint pilot training program at Shepherd Air Force Base in Texas. Would you please welcome this year's Chancellor's Award winner, George Watkins.
Will Matt McGraw please come to the podium? Matt is the president of the Student Government Association. He's going to present two special awards this afternoon, the Outstanding Faculty Award from the students as well as the Outstanding Staff Award.
Every semester, students nominate faculty members who they believe to be the most outstanding of that semester. This year, we had about a dozen people that were nominated, and our winner received three of those nominations. He won a Presidential Innovation Award, and everybody please welcome Dr. Daryl Smith. This year, the SGA realized that we hadn't been really recognizing our staff enough. Our staff really pull and help our faculty succeed, and they help all of us through all of our tough times a lot too. So we decided to start the SGA Outstanding Staff Award. We received about 14 nominations. This individual received two of those nominations, and I think everybody here knows her and loves her as helping you through many, many different things. Ms. Tricia Hurst, would you please come forward?
Professor Lee, please come to the podium. You can stand right on the where the feet are. It's a special privilege to be able to give Lou Anne some direction since we've depended on her for so many years to give us direction. Today is a day that marks transitions and passages. Many people, young people, that we're proud to welcome and usher them into the world of work and challenge and dreams. And one of ours is retiring this year after 22 years of service to the students and to the community of this campus. Lou Anne Lee has achieved the prestigious label of finishing with the award of Professor Emerita. What that means in academics, if I might use an analogy, it's like getting into the Hall of Fame after a lifetime of prestigious sports activity. It is a mark of distinction, and it's a mark of permanent recognition by the faculty and by the administration of the university. Lou Anne Lee is taught in the Humanities Social Science Department, where she problem-solved, taught classes, helped everyone make decisions. She was a Board of Trustees member, served with distinction. She, most recently in the last few years, has been the Associate Dean for the campus, has steered us through many periods of turmoil, as well as has been there during some of our high points. She has given papers as a faculty member, written papers, directed conferences, in short, all that it means to profess. When I think about Luann, I think about her as a, in a positive way, as a tool that climbers use, especially high altitude climbers climbing in ice and treacherous areas, the pick hammer that's thrown higher than you are now. You sink it deep into the ice. You claim that high ground so the feet can follow. We have been that feet. Luann has been that pick. And that's why when I did select the quote for her plaque, I quoted from Ulysses, from Tennyson, where he underlined the whole point to life, to strive and to seek and never to yield. And those words reminded me of Luann. Please help me celebrate Luann's retirement with this award of Professor Emerita.
So, my friends, this is what comes from seeking to do what you love and loving what you do, and from having a life's partner who encourages and supports every choice. I encourage you to hold fast to your dreams, to remember your teachers, honor your families, treasure your friends. We're counting on you to take the lead. Together, you will make a difference. Auf Wiedersehen.
Returning again, Fred Cohn, the interim director of the School of Aviation Sciences, present the diplomas to his graduates.
I'd like to ask the candidates for a degree, a Bachelor of Science degree in Aeronautical Science, to please rise and come forward at this time.
Jeremy Wayne Ballantyne. Yero Tobiah Banco. Christina Barrett. Graduating cum laude, Christian Jens Bearskov. Michael Stewart Blasio. Terry James Boom. Candidate for honors, Brian Keith Brown. Sean Michael Brown. Graduating summa cum laude, Robert Arnold Carlson. Andrea Marie Childs. Graduating cum laude, Jeffrey Allen Chrisman. Matthew Thomas Davies. Keith Douglas Dottage. Kevin Michael Dukes. Jeffrey Allen Duncan. Jonathan Philip Eubank. Claude Gilbert Florescu. Candidate for honors, Dina Louise Haberly. Terry Shea Hall. Natalie Patricia Holm. James Hubbard. Matthew Joseph Jones. Jonathan James Callback.
Yeah, Callback! Woo!
Kevin Michael Kent. Michael Blaine Krause. Graduating cum laude, Shane Michael Murphy. Graduating magna cum laude, Keone C. Nipo. Kimberly Nicole Knave. Second Lieutenant Chris Nelson. Megan Marie Nelson. Timothy David Norman. Graduating cum laude, William Osigatha. Graduating cum laude, Rocky Von Parton. Tony
right.
Paul Plum. Jerome Duke Robinson. Christopher Joseph Rose. Robert Terrence Sadler IV. Denise Stein. Graduating cum laude, Abraham Frederico Viramontes. Nicholas William Wanner. Candidate for honors, James Thomas Woods, Jr. Christopher Paul Wright.
And now will the candidates for a bachelor's degree in professional aeronautics please come forward.
Kevin Lewis Abel. Graduating cum laude, Curtis Wayne Crisp. Gerard John Gaskey. James P. Tracy. Graduating cum laude, William V. Wolf.
Mr. John Jenkins, Interim Director of the School of Arts and Sciences, will now present diplomas to Aerospace Studies candidates.
Will the candidates for Bachelor of Science degree in Aerospace Studies please come forward?
Edward Cruz. Carol Finley Tomlinson III. Cheryl Raquel Urquhart.
Dr. Richard Bloom will now present diplomas to the candidates for the Science, Technology, and Globalization degree.
With a great, great deal of pride, I invite the candidates for graduation in a Science, Technology, and Globalization program to please come forward.
Graduating magna cum laude, Melanie Joan Antonich. Dustin Dale Budd. Second Lieutenant Matthew Martin Malone.
Professor Tracy Dorlin will come forward to present diplomas to the aerospace engineering candidates.
Will the candidates for the Bachelor of Science degree in aerospace engineering please come forward?
Graduating cum laude, Michael J. Allen. Brian Dean Hall. Adrian Duncan Ishwaraya. Second Lieutenant Heidi Marie Kaiser. Graduating magna cum laude, Brian Scott Kernegie. Julie Ann Moon. Graduating cum laude, Second Lieutenant Joseph Aro Morris. Graduating summa cum laude, Arvin Rahman. J. Michael Soblum. Graduating cum laude, Second Lieutenant Isaac Samuel Scholl. Rodri Thomas. Daniel Lee True. David Lee True.
Dr. Chuck Cohn, Chair of Electrical Engineering, will present diplomas to his candidates.
Will candidates for degree of Bachelor of Science in Electrical Engineering please come forward?
Yeah,
Second Lieutenant Robert Paul Barron, Jr. Second Lieutenant Anthony Lawrence Barreras. Second Lieutenant Michael Kennedy Dodson. Second Lieutenant Noel Vance Grothy. Graduating magna cum laude, Second Lieutenant Skyler Devin Hester. Scott Allen Hussey. Graduating summa cum laude, Second Lieutenant Kyle Richard McAtee. Second Lieutenant Matthew Jacob McCarty. Second Lieutenant Jason Daniel McGrogan. Graduating summa cum laude, Second Lieutenant Peter Eric Moon. Graduating magna cum laude, Second Lieutenant Timothy Edward Naroff. Second Lieutenant Rachel Marie Platts. Second Lieutenant Matthew Edward Ray. Second Lieutenant Jeremy Mark Rose. Graduating cum laude, Mr. Eric James Shipley. Second Lieutenant Kenneth Joseph Lewis Tice. Second Lieutenant Kenneth George Thill. Graduating magna cum laude, Second Lieutenant George Ryan Watkins. Second Lieutenant Frank William Welton.
Dr. Matt Jaffe, Chair of Computer Sciences, will present diplomas to his candidates.
Will the candidate for the bachelor's degree in aviation computer science please come forward?
Patrick D. Dunn. Letitia Reyes.
And will our candidates for degree in computer science please come forward?
Andrew Raymond Paquette. Andrew Joseph Werner, Jr.
Candidate for the degree of Bachelor of Science in Management of Technical Operations, please come forward.
Stephen James Smith.
Candidates For the master's degrees, please come forward to receive your diploma.
Graduating with distinction, Major Scott Stephen Burgess. Jessica Kathleen Dickman. Chester L. Gandy. Philip Duncan Huffines. Graduating with the degree, a Master of Business Administration, with distinction, Farron James Cordry.
Will all the candidates for degrees please rise? I invite Mr. John Olson, member of our Board of Trustees, to join me at the podium. Mr. John Olson, upon the recommendation of the faculty of the university, it gives me great honor to present to you the candidates for degrees.
Ladies and gentlemen, graduates, it's my pleasure as trustee of this university to make it all legal. By the authority vested in me by the Board of Trustees of Embry-Riddle Aeronautical University, I hereby confer upon you, as appropriate, the Bachelor of Science and Master of Sciences degrees with the rights, privileges, honors, and responsibilities appertaining to hereunto. You may now remove your tassels from the right to the left side of your mortarboard to signify that you have graduated. Congratulations to all of you.
This ceremony would not be complete if we did not take the time to recognize all of those who have supported the achievements we have just celebrated. The faculty have played a key role in preparing the students for this occasion. The staff have supported all the services and the activities of the campus, and the families and friends of the graduates have made personal commitments and sacrifices to support these men and women in pursuit of their dreams. I would like to give the graduates this opportunity to give them all a round of applause. Following the benediction and the recessional, we will be having a reception for the graduates, their families, our faculty and staff in the building next door, which would be out this back and out to the left. And I welcome you all there.
Adrian Ezraria, a graduate in aerospace engineering from Cheltenham, United Kingdom, will deliver the benediction.
Let us pray. We give you thanks, Almighty Lord, for all the blessings you have showered upon us. We thank you for carrying us through the tough times and for helping us achieve what once seemed impossible. We thank you for bringing to us our loved ones, that they have been able to share this momentous occasion. Today we ask that you bless this, our graduation day. Bless the graduates and help them embark on their journeys through life. Bless our professors. Without them, we would never have arrived here today. Bless our parents, friends, and all the other people who have helped us and had confidence in us. Lord, we also ask that you look over those who arrived here at Embry-Riddle with us, but for differing reasons are not with us today. We ask that today be in our memories forever, and this graduation be remembered as the best ever. In your sacred heart we trust and pray, amen.
Color guard, would you please retire the colors?